First Samuel 29. If you look with me, please, at verse 1, we read, "Then the Philistines gathered together all their armies at Aphek, and the Israelites encamped by a fountain which is in Jezreel." Just to put this together for us and to connect last Sunday's teaching, if you weren't here for that, I'd encourage you to get the free CD and get up to speed on that. These chapters fit together here. If you look in your Bible at 1 Samuel 28, verse 4, 1 Samuel 28, verse 4, we read, "Then the Philistines gathered together and came and encamped at Shunem, and so Saul gathered all Israel together, and they encamped at Gilboa." Here in chapter 29, the story is continuing, but the perspective is changing a little bit. There in chapter 28, the Philistines have come up against Israel. They're meeting in the Valley of Jezreel, or the Valley of Armageddon. We talked about that. And the Philistines are going to battle against the nation of Israel, and Saul is freaking out. He is scared. And so what Saul does is he goes and he seeks out a medium. He seeks out a witch. He seeks out somebody who can run a seance for him and help him connect with Samuel, because he wants to have a word from the Lord. And he's concerned about this battle. And we talked about that last week. Well, that's the same battle that's then mentioned here in 1 Samuel 29. All we're doing is shifting the camera lens, if you will, as we watch this story unfold from Saul in the midst of the nation of Israel and their armies to now our attention is drawn to the Philistines who have come to battle against Israel, and there we find David. At this point, David has allied himself with the Philistines now for about 14 months. He's been living in the city of Ziklag. He's been going out and doing raiding parties against the nations that are around the Philistines. He has ingratiated himself to his Philistine hosts. And now, as this battle is lining up and starting to take some form here with the Philistines against Israel, the story continues to unfold for us this morning. Verse 2, 1 Samuel 29, "The lords of the Philistines passed in review by hundreds and by thousands, but David and his men passed in review at the rear with Achish. Then the princes of the Philistines said, 'What are these Hebrews doing here, or these people of Israel, David and his men?' And Achish said to the princes of the Philistines, 'Is this not David, the servant of Saul, king of Israel, who has been with me these days or these years?'" There were two different times that David allied himself with Achish, and so he says, "Hey, I know this guy. He's been with me for a while. And to this day, I have found no fault in him, in David, since he defected to me." This is how good David's ruse was, is that Achish believed that David had really defected to him. "But the princes of the Philistines were angry with him, with Achish. And so the princes of the Philistines said to him, 'Make this fellow," referring to David, "make this fellow return, make him go away, that he may go back to the place which you have appointed for him, and do not let him go down with us to the battle.'" And they give the reason why: "Lest in the battle he become our adversary, lest he turn on us. For with what could David reconcile himself to his master," referring to Saul, "if not with the heads of these men," these Philistine warriors? "Is this not David, of whom they sang to one another in dances, saying, 'Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s?'" What an interesting place David finds himself in. Here the Philistines are arrayed against the nation of Israel. They are going to do battle against them, and they get together and they align themselves and they march and they show off, much as you see the video of South Korea or Russia, you know, pulling their missiles through the streets, and there be these big cheering parties and this sort of thing, showing off their might and their strength. This is what is happening here. But at the end of the parade, well, here comes David and his men. And the other Philistine lords, the other Philistine kings, if you will, they look on and they go, "Wait a minute, this guy can't go into battle with us. As sure as we get into battle, he'll turn on us. And what a better way to ingratiate himself to his master Saul is by, you know, killing a few hundred or a few thousand Philistines from the back lines here in the war. Isn't this David, isn't this the one that the people sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his ten thousands? Watch it quickly as we make our way through this portion of the text pretty fast. I want you to see this picture here where these pagan kings, well, they have a better memory and they have greater faith in what David has done and who the God of David is. They don't want David anywhere around with them going into battle. They don't believe in David. They don't believe in David's God. They want nothing to do with that. But they remember better than David does about God's faithfulness in David's life to have caused him to be such a wonderful and such a glorious warrior. Well, let's see what unfolds. Well, verse 6, Achish called David and said to him, surely, as the Lord lives, you have been upright, not so much, and you're going out and you're coming in with me in the army is good in my sight. For to this day I have not found evil in you since the day of your coming to me. That's because David was a good liar. He was a good deceiver. Nevertheless, the Lord's do not favor you. Therefore return now and go in peace that you may not displease the lords of the Philistines. So David, we'll get it in the upcoming verses, David is in fact going to go. He will be obedient to what Achish has commanded him to do. He will make his way back to his hometown of Ziklag. And notice that the motivation, verse 7 here, is given. Hey, David, just go ahead and go away. Don't go to battle with us. Just go back to your own town. You know, separate yourself away from us so we wouldn't displease the Lord of the Philistines. Hey, David, I'm just curious. Is there any chance that you're displeasing God in aligning yourself with the enemy? David, is there any chance that you're displeasing God in lining up with the enemy to do battle against your own people, Israel? What about the concern there? What about the concern about displeasing God? You're concerned about displeasing these Philistine lords. You're going to be obedient to what Achish asked you to do for that reason. What about God's displeasure? Would there ever be any time that it'd be more important to us that we don't upset the boss, but upset God? Oh man, you know, it's not the right thing to do, but if I don't do it, my boss, he's going to get really angry with me. He's going to cut my hours, or he's going to put me on double overtime, or he's going to take away my truck and give me the old nasty work truck that nobody ever wants to drive. Am I going to displease the Lord? Or am I going to displease the boss? Verse 8. So David said to Achish, but what have I done? Yeah, God knows what he's done. And to this day, what have you found in your servant as long as I have been with you? Well, he hasn't found anything, again, because David's such a good liar. That I may not go and fight against the enemies of my Lord, the king. David, when you use this phrase, my enemies, you're referring to your own people, Israel. And again, that you would call Achish your Lord? That you would call him your king? And Christian, as you're taking notes or writing in the margin of your Bible, here at verse 8, you may want to write the word backslidden. This is that place when you're in a backslidden state where you come into this place where you go, I never thought it would end up here. I never could have imagined. I can't believe that I've backslidden so far away from the things of the Lord. I've stepped so far away from the things of God that I would refer to my own people as the enemy. That I would refer to this pagan king as my Lord, the king. That I would lead, well, myself and my 600 warriors in battle against my own people. This is where I end up. And it's amazing, gang, that Satan will never bring this out. He'll never point this out. He'll never help us understand, hey, you know, if you continue to go in this direction, if you continue to backslide, if you continue to, you know, push away the things of God, you know, this is where you're going to end up. You're going to end up in the enemy camp, calling the enemy king, your Lord and your king. Satan never says that. He never gives us that picture. Do you think that for David, maybe as these words rolled out of his mouth, do you think, would you hope that there was some sense within him? He was like, I can't believe I'm saying this. I can't believe that this is where I would have ended up. Verse 9, Achish answered and said to David, I know that you are as good in my sight as an angel of God. We know the things David was doing when he wasn't in Achish's sight. There's no angel of God there. Nevertheless, the princes of the Philistines have said, he, David, shall not go up with us to the battle. Now therefore, rise early in the morning with your master's servants who have come with you, and as soon as you are up early in the morning and have light, depart. And so David and his men rose early to depart in the morning to return to the land of the Philistines, to return to his city of Ziklag. And the Philistines went up to Jezreel. So they're continuing to position themselves to bring the battle to Saul. So just to remember that we have these the couple of chapters here that the story is running concurrently between the chapters as we just look at either side of the battle as to what's happening. Chapter 30. Verse 1, we'll read through the chapter and then we'll come back and take a look at it. Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had invaded the south in Ziklag, attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were there from small to great. They did not kill anyone but carried them away and went their way. And so David and his men came to the city, and there it was burned with fire, and their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Then David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, had been taken captive. Now David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David, and so David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered him, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without fail recover all. So David went, he and the 600 men who were with him, and came to the brook Bezor, where those stayed who were left behind. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 stayed behind, who were so weary that they could not cross the brook Bezor. Then they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David, and they gave him bread, and he ate, and they let him drink water. And they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. And so when he had eaten, his strength came back to him, for he had eaten no bread nor drunk water for 3 days and three nights. Then David said to him, to whom do you belong, and where are you from? And he said, I am a young man from Egypt, servant of an Amalekite, and my master left me behind because 3 days ago I fell sick. We made an invasion of the southern area of the Cherethites and the territory which belongs to Judah, and of the southern area of Caleb, and we burned Ziklag with fire. David said to him, can you take me down to this troop? So he said, swear to me by God that you will neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, and I will take you down to this troop. And when he had brought him down, there they were, spread out over all the land, eating and drinking and dancing, because of all the great spoil which they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. Then David attacked them from twilight until the evening of the next day. Not a man of them escaped, except 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. And so David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything which they had taken from them. David recovered all. Then David took all of the flocks and the herds they had driven before those other livestock and said, "This is David's spoil." Now David came to the 200 men who had been so weary that they could not follow David, whom they also had made to stay at the brook Bezor. And so they went out to meet David and to meet the people who were with him. And when David came near the people, he greeted them. Then all the wicked and worthless men of those who went with David answered and said, "Because they did not go with us, we will not give them any of the spoil that we have recovered, except for every man's wife and children, that they may lead them away and depart." But David said, "My brethren, ye shall not do so with what the Lord has given us, who has preserved us and delivered into our hand the troop that came against us, for who will heed you in this matter? But as his part is who goes down to the battle, so shall his part be who stays by the supplies. They shall share alike." And so it was from that day forward. He made it a statute and an ordinance for Israel to this day. Now when David came to Ziklag, he sent some of the spoil to the elders of Judah, to his friends, saying, "Here is a present for you from the spoil of the enemies of the Lord." And verses 27 through 30 define who those individuals are. And then verse 31 says, "Those who are in Hebron, into all the places where David himself and his men were accustomed to rove." So as we come into chapter 30, we now have some background as we get to this story. What's going on? David is not going to be going with the Philistines to battle. And he has been, by Achish, he has been sent home back to his own town. And we read there in verse 1, "Now it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites," those are the Amalekites from King Agag fame, those Amalekites that Saul was supposed to wipe out, "the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag attacked Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken captive the women and those who were from there, from small to great. They did not kill anyone, but carried them away and went their way." Yeah, they didn't kill anyone because, well, there were no warriors within Ziklag. They were all with David up at the battlefront, and they took everybody there alive. Well, they were going to take him to Egypt to sell him into slavery. See, I want to have this picture. David is in the place that he should not be. David has aligned himself with this pagan king, Achish. He has gone with the Philistines to go do battle against the nation of Israel. He's left nobody behind in Ziklag. His home is untended. His home is uncared for. His home is unguarded. And the enemy comes in and takes away their wives and their children. Father, dad, husband, have you aligned yourself with the enemy in such a way? Are you away pursuing the things of the enemy instead of the things of the Lord? And one day there's going to come a day where you come home and you find you've lost your wife. You've lost your children. The enemy has come because your home was untended. It was uncared for. It was unguarded. The covering, the protection, the spiritual leadership that you were to bring in your home, you weren't there. You were backslidden to the point that you're off with the enemies doing battle against the people of God. Listen, Christian. You find yourself wrapped up and caught up in false doctrine. You find yourself wrapped up and caught up in a movement and a motivation of pride and self-promotion. And while you pursue these things and you do battle against the people of God and you do battle against those who teach God's word honestly, will you lose your family? Will the enemy come and take your wife and your children? This is what happened to David. David, in the place that he should not be, backslidden to the point that he has aligned himself with the enemy, the Philistines. And think about it, the Amalekites, all the Philistines, they're off in the north. They're all up at the Valley of Armageddon getting ready to do battle against the nation of Israel. And the Amalekites look on and go, "Well, hey, you know what? The Philistines, nobody's home. They're all up doing battle against the Israelites in the north. Hey, let's check it out. Oh, look at this. This town of Ziklag, Oh, there's not a watchman on the walls. There's not a warrior in the city. It's just the women and children that are here. Well, we'll take them. And they did. And so David and his men came to the city. And there it was, the city burned with fire. And their wives, their sons, and their daughters had been taken captive. Not only did they lose their wives and sons and daughters, they lost all their stuff. If you've ever had the opportunity to either be robbed or have something of yours burn, maybe a vehicle burn or a home burn or a garage burn, you know how painful it can be to lose your stuff. Even if it was stuff you really didn't care about, it was still your stuff. But now imagine losing your wife and your children as well. You come home and there's nothing there. Look at the response. David and the people who were with him lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. I want to pull for you out of this verse a very important element. Notice that David and the people. Remember that 1 and 2 Samuel, it's a story of the life of Samuel and Saul and David. That's what it's covering. And so notice here, the Holy Spirit wants us to see that David doesn't look on at this destruction and go, oh, wow, this is kind of interesting. Man, well, forget it. You know what, guys? We can get more wives and more kids. We can get more stuff. You know, off we go. No. David is destroyed. Look at this. They lifted up their voices and wept until they had no more power to weep. Christian, have you ever wept to the place where you can't generate any more tears? Where your guts, your rib cage, it hurts from the sobbing and the gasping for air. You're absolutely destroyed. You cannot weep any longer. And why would David weep so powerfully? I would submit to you two reasons. Number one would be the loss of his family, the loss of his stuff. But I'd submit to you further from where we're going to go in the one verse that we're really looking at and focusing on this morning, it will be to in a moment. David weeps not only because of loss, but David weeps because of the responsibility. All of this is my fault. 600 warriors that are following me have lost their wives, have lost their sons, have lost their daughters, have lost their homes, have lost the safety and the security of their city, and it's my fault. I am the one responsible. And the Holy Spirit, as if to help us understand and to draw in the point, look at verse 5, and David's two wives, the Holy Spirit wants us to know, David was touched, he was impacted, this disaster grabbed a hold of him, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the widow of Nabal the Carmelite, they had been taken captive as well. For David, this is not only a loss, this is a personal loss. For David, he is not only responsible, David is personally responsible. And look at how bad it was, verse 6. David was greatly distressed. David is wiped out. David is destroyed. David was greatly distressed. This is not a Hebrew way of saying that David was having kind of a bad day, but tomorrow the sun would come out and everything would be better then. No. David was greatly distressed. He is as low as a man can go. How bad was it? Well, it's bad enough when you are distressed on your own. It's bad enough when you have wept all you can weep, when you have sobbed all you can sob, when you have screamed all you can see. That is bad. Can it get worse? And look at verse 6, the people spoke of stoning him. because the soul of the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. Notice this, that the people spoke of stoning him. Now, we want to make sure we stay accurate to the text. The people that want to stone him, they aren't people that kind of like live in the country and they kind of have a general idea who David is. These are David's crack troops. These are the 600 men that have aligned themselves with David, who have followed him through thick and thin. These are the ones who came to David when they were distressed, when they were depressed, when they were in debt, when their lives were destroyed. And this is the man who has led them in battle, who has brought them and molded and shaped them into crack warriors. This is a man who has given them hope for their future. This is a man who has been used by the Lord to redeem their lives into being something of value. How bad is the situation? They want to kill him. And they don't want to kill him by chopping off his head or, you know, throwing a spear through his heart. They want to kill him by stoning him. That is not an easy, quick way to die. That is a painful, long, drawn out, difficult, as you can imagine, way to die. David, he's greatly distressed. He's so greatly distressed because of his loss, because of his responsibility, but also because those who he has been used to lead now are turning on him and wanting to stone him. Notice the depth of their anger, of their frustration, of their loss, of their pain. Notice this. The text says that the soul of all the people was grieved. They were grieved to the very center of their soul. Let me see if I can do this a different way. Think about somebody in your life you know who's died. Teacher, great aunt or uncle, somebody in the neighborhood. You know, somebody that you knew, you went to the funeral, you went to the visitation, you went to the funeral, you went to the little reception afterwards, but they weren't really related to you. They were some distance from you. And kind of think about how you felt and how you went through that process. Now think about going through the funeral of your child. Let's say child under the age of 18. Would there be like a different feeling in your heart? Would you kind of move through that process in a different way? I think that you would. The soul of all the people was grieved. And look at this. The Holy Spirit is clear for us. He wants us to know. He wants us to understand. Every man for his sons and his daughters. The Holy Spirit wants us to see that every man lost his family. Every man. There was nobody who was not touched. Every man lost his sons and his daughters. And notice the possession that's communicated to us there. Every man lost his sons and his daughters. Everybody was touched by personal tragic loss because of David, because of his foolishness, because of his stupidity, because of his backslidden state, because of his sin, because of his wickedness, because of him allying himself with the enemy. Why do I spend so much time, you know, drawing out this point that is so very painful? Because it makes the last phrase of the verse so wonderful. Verse 6, last sentence. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. David strengthened himself in the Lord. I read this, but David strengthened himself in the Lord. And let me read it to you. It made me think of Ephesians chapter 2. I will read the first few verses to you. Paul writes in Ephesians 2, "And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. Here it comes. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ Jesus. David is in an absolutely terrible situation. But David strengthened himself in the Lord. Let's take a look at that a minute here, please, if we can. Notice we've emphasized the word but, the contrast, the pivot point here for David's life, for his walk, for his relationship with the Lord. But David, notice the next word, the word is strengthened. Or a synonymous word for it, if you're taking note or writing in your Bible, could be the word encouraged. David strengthened, or he encouraged himself in the Lord. This is not the power of positive thinking. But this is the beginning of brokenness that leads to repentance and reconciliation. Let me say that again. David strengthened himself in the Lord. This is not the power of positive thinking. You know the little engine that could? I think I can. This is not the word of faith. If you just speak it and you believe it, it will happen. This is not the power of positive thinking, but this is the beginning of brokenness. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Notice that he strengthened himself. He strengthened himself. He didn't turn to the latest book. He didn't turn to the latest DVD series. He didn't turn to his closest girlfriend. He didn't turn to his closest bro-friend. He didn't turn to some other religious leader. Notice that he strengthened, or he encouraged himself. One of the things that we seek to do here, Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, that God has given to the church, pastor teachers, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, to equip the saints so that when the storms of life come, we have the ability to encourage ourselves in the Lord, to open our Bible, to know where to turn, to open our Bible and to know this particular psalm or this area of scripture, to encourage ourselves in the Lord. There's nothing wrong, and it's good to pray with other people and to have fellowship with other people and to receive biblical guidance and counsel and to receive assistance and to enjoy that fellowship of faith. But there are those times where the issues of life, the beginnings of brokenness, have to happen on the level between me and God alone. David, he strengthened himself. Notice the next word, in. He strengthened himself in the Lord his God. In the Lord his God. He strengthened himself in the Lord. He didn't strengthen himself about the Lord. There is an element within me that when I have the unfortunate opportunity to walk into a Christian bookstore, there's just something in there that I just... You ever notice a Christian bookstore? If you're lucky, you may have one row of Bibles. Some Christian bookstores, they have like a corner. Oh, you're looking for a Bible? Yeah, I think we have a few back there in the corner if you want to kind of take a look. The rest of the store? Oh, it's books about the Bible. Little tchotchkes you can wear around your neck and clip onto your purse or cover your Bible. Little doodads you can hang from your ceiling, plaster to your wall, hang in your window. That, well, it's a fish, it's a cross, it's a this, it's an angels, it's that. And then we have the DVD section, and we have the greeting card section, and we have the video section. Now, is there a place for those things? It probably is, to a certain degree. But when you come to the place of brokenness, when you come to the place, this pivot point that David is at, the only thing that is going to be bring strength, the only thing that is going to bring encouragement is for one to strengthen themselves in the Lord. That means this. That means prayer. That means meditation. That means waiting upon the Lord, taking a long walk, with the Lord and with the Word, waiting upon Him and hearing from Him. Bible open, notepad handy, pen out. Lord, what would you have to say to me? But finally, notice David strengthened himself in the Lord. Notice that little word there, his God. We can't blow past that. Maybe you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with God, and then you come into a storm of life and you go, who is this God again? What do I do? I think, you know, this doesn't work for me. It worked for my parents, but it never works for me. No. It starts with a personal relationship. David may have been backslidden. David may have turned away from the things of God. David may have aligned himself with the enemy. David has made, 14 months worth of just mistakes and stupid sin. But he was still God's man. And he was still a man that had a relationship with God. And when he got ready to be broken, when he got ready to repent, when he got ready to turn back to the Lord, notice this, that he turned back to the Lord who was his God. That we cannot, I'm sorry, I'm taking it apart word by word, and if I'm killing you, I'm killing you, take it up with me later. But we can't blow past this point, because how many of us, when we come to that point in life where we need to turn, we do exactly have that response. You know, this works for everybody. You know, this works for Pastor Tom, but it ain't working for me. Christian, I have to ask you, are you a Christian? Do you have that relationship with God? Is God your God? Because if he isn't, it's not going to work. You need to start with salvation, then come into this place. See, David, he may have neglected, he may have walked away from, he may have abused his relationship with God, but this is the God that has said to David and to you and I, will never leave you or forsake you. This is the God that says, I've inscribed you on the palm of my hand. I've inscribed you right there. You know what that inscription looks like? The inscription on the palm of his hand, it looks like the piercing of a nail. God says, hey, you know what? A mother may forget her nursing young, but I will never forget you. David, you may have wandered a long way. You may have gotten into a lot of things. But when it came time to turn, David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. Now, I hope, I didn't bring it up, but I hope you have highlighted that verse. Or put a circle on the page number of your Bible. Or folded the page over if you're so willing. So you know where to find this verse. Because this is a verse that you need. So David, he encourages himself in the Lord. Alan Redpath says this, immediately when David touched rock bottom, he turned back to God. At the very first uplifting of that tear-stained face, the very first moment the Lord looked down and saw his broken-hearted child weeping until he could weep no more, then heaven answered with an immediate word of power and victory and sent David out to conquer. We'll get that in a moment. That moment became for David the gateway into victory, the stepping stone into blessing, the beginning of the accomplishment of God's purposes for his life. David would write in Psalm 18, in my distress I called upon the Lord. I cried out to my God. He heard my voice from his temple, and my cry came before him even to his ears. That's Psalm 18, verse 6. Psalm 40, verse 1, I waited patiently for the Lord, David wrote, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. Redpath again. Do you really desire that God may bring you into victory and blessing today? Then the moment you stand with a broken heart amid the ruins of your self-life, acknowledging the futility of fighting against God, When you turn your eyes upon Jesus and lift your tear-stained face to your wonderful Lord, at that moment, He not only lifts you up, but brings you victory and sends you out to pursue your enemy and his. David, he strengthened himself in the Lord his God. I couldn't help thinking of two additional examples. There are more, but Acts chapter 16, verse 23, Paul and Silas, when they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely. And having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's chains were loosed. Paul and Silas, they strengthened themselves in the Lord. And then, of course, our sweet Lord and Savior Jesus. John 17, Jesus strengthens himself in the Lord, his high priestly prayer. John 17, Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have glorified you on the earth. I've finished the work which you have given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. Jesus strengthened himself in the Lord. Well, verse 7. David said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, please bring the ephod here to me. And Abiathar brought the ephod to David, and so David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this troop? Shall I overtake them? And the Lord answered David and said, pursue, for you shall surely overtake them, and without fail recover all. Three S's if you're taking note. The first, David strengthened himself in the Lord. Number one, David strengthened himself in the Lord. Number two, David sought the Lord for new direction. David sought the Lord for new direction. And number three, David submitted to the Lord. He strengthened himself in the Lord. He sought the Lord. And he submitted to the Lord. And this is that which makes David a man after God's own heart. This is not the first time we've watched David mess up. This will not be the last time we watch David mess up. And Christian, I don't know about you, but since we were together last Sunday, I have not walked in perfection and holiness and sin-free. Maybe one of you have, but I haven't. I've made a few mistakes over the course of this last week. But you know what? I have a heart after God. And Christian, I believe that you have hearts after God. Because when we fall, when we mess up, when we sin, we strengthen ourselves in the Lord, we seek the Lord for a new direction, and then we submit to whatever God tells us to do. And that's what makes David, and that's what makes me, and that's what makes you individuals with hearts after God. One more time with Red Path. Sorry about three quotes from him today, but, you know, if somebody can say it better than you, you may as well just go with what they said, because it's... Redpath says this, if your self-will, your rejection of God's principles of life, your compromises have driven you into a desperate plight, remember that God loves you, that he is still planning great things for you, and that he alone can deliver you. The moment you stop fighting against him and humble yourself before him, when you encourage yourself in the Lord and inquire of him, at that moment he is there. In fact, he is with you right now to do for you as he did for David, to give you victory and blessing. One more time. If your self-will, your rejection of God's principles of life, your compromises have driven you into a desperate plight, remember that God loves you, that he's still planning great things for you, and that he alone can deliver you. The moment you stop fighting against him and humble yourself before him, when you encourage yourself in the Lord and inquire of him, at that moment he is there. In fact, he's with you right now to do for you as he did for David, to give you victory and blessing. Three S's. David strengthened himself in the Lord. David sought the Lord. David submitted to the Lord. So verse 9. So David went, he and the 600 men who were with him, and came to the brook Bezor, where those who stayed who were left behind. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 stayed behind who were so weary that they could not cross the brook Bezor. Just a little side note. No, it was a three-day hike of 25 miles a day to get from Jezreel down to this brook Bezor. So there was a third of David's army that went, you know what? We can't keep going. And then, verse 11, they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David, and they gave him bread, and he ate, and they let him drink water. And they gave him a piece of a cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. So when he had eaten, the Egyptian, when he had eaten, his strength came back to him, for he'd eaten no bread nor drunk water for 3 days and three nights. And the Amalekites cast him aside. Hey, you're weak. You're just a servant. You're just a slave. You're a zero. You count nothing to us. We'll cast you aside. David and his men pick him up and show him compassion and care for him. And once they've nursed him to some health here, David said to him, to whom do you belong and where are you from? And he said, I'm a young man from Egypt, servant of an Amalekite, and my master left me behind because 3 days ago I fell sick. That's the way the world will work. Use you till he can't get anything else out of you, and then we'll cast you aside so we can keep on going. We made an invasion of the southern area of the Cherethites and the territory which belongs to Judah and of the southern area of Caleb, and we burned Ziklag with fire. And David said to him, can you take me down to this troop? In other words, can you show me where they've gone? And the Egyptian said, swear to me by God that you will neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, the Amalekites, and I will take you down to this troop. And when the Egyptian had brought David down, there they were, the Amalekites, spread out over all the land, eating and drinking and dancing because of all the great spoil which they had taken from the land of the Philistines and from the land of Judah. Can you imagine their glee? All the Philistines go away to battle, and the Amalekites come in and just start ransacking their city and stealing their spoil, because in the Philistine cities, maybe there were just only a few people guarding. In David's city, there's nobody guarding. They are partying down. They have no expectation or anticipation that anyone is going to be coming after them, because there's this huge battle happening 3 days north up in Jezreel between the Philistines and the Israelites, and everybody's busy about that battle, and nobody wants in the home front. And so, verse 17, David attacked them from twilight until the evening of the next day. There's some discussion about the interpretation of the word twilight there. One commentator and scholar, Baldwin, says that the word should actually be translated dawn. I think that fits. Because if you imagine that David and his men have had a three-day march to get to this place, they're tired, they come upon the Amalekites, there they are partying down, drunken. David and his men, hey, they take the night to rest. And the next morning, when the Amalekites are hungover in a stupor, they fall upon them. And they wipe them out, pretty much. Not a man of them escaped, except 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. So how many thousands of warriors were there if 400 got away on camels? And so David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away, and David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything which they had taken from them. They even got their stuff back. And David recovered all. Now I asked you to find Joel, Joel chapter 2. Let's go there quickly. So we watch the clock as well. Joel 2, verse 25. God is calling Judah to repentance. Judah has been living in sin. Judah has backslidden far away from God. Judah has suffered for their sin. They've lost their stuff. They've lost their people. They've lost their fields. They've lost their provisions. And God is calling them to repentance, to come back to him. And in Joel 2:25, he says this, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten. The crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust, my great army, which I sent among you, Joel 2:25. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be put to shame. God says, if you will leave the boyfriend or the girlfriend that you're sleeping with, if you will leave the bad business relationship that you're in, if you will leave these things that are sucking you and draining you dry, that are bringing corruption into your life, if you will come to repentance and brokenness and you will come back to me, I will restore. I love you. I care for you. I want to bless you. David recovered all. I'm back in 1 Samuel. Then David took all the flocks and herds that they, the Amalekites, had driven before those other livestock and said, this is David's spoil. In other words, all the things, all the stuff that didn't belong to Ziklag that the Amalekites had taken, David says, hey, we're going to take that all to ourselves as well, and this will be our spoils of war, our spoils of the battle. So they not only got back all their families, they not only got back all their stuff, but they got back over and above everything else that the Amalekites had taken from everybody else. David and the gang got all that stuff as well. They called it David's spoil. Now David came to the 200 men who had been so weary that they could not follow David, whom they also had made to stay at the brook Bezor. We got this back in verse 10. And so they went out to meet David and to meet the people who were with him. That's a very innocuous way of saying there was a family reunion. That the people who were with him were all the wives and sons and daughters that are coming back. Now I want to make a note here about this a moment. The people who were with David who are coming back, all the sons and the daughters and the wives, were they all restored? Did all the families come back together? Yep. Did they get all their stuff back? Yep. Were there any consequences? Well, you would have to imagine. Think of the terror that those moms and sons and daughters lived through as they watched their entire city be burned to the ground. Think of the persecution that they faced. Oh, none of them might have been killed, but were any of them raped? Or even tortured? How were they persecuted in any way? For the littlest kids, for them to have gone through that experience of being taken captive by the Amalekites, all of those people thinking that their next stop was going to be Egypt to be sold in slavery, were there consequences? I bet there were. See, God is faithful to restore. God is faithful to deliver. God is faithful to bring out. God is faithful to bless over and above. But the consequences of our backsliddenness, if I can make that word up right now on the fly, the consequences remain. So David, and here they come back, and the people who are with him. And when David came near the people, he greeted them. Then all the wicked and worthless men of those who went with David answered and said, we won't go there and take a look, but if you want, your Bible students, you want to take a note, 1 Chronicles 12, 19 to 22. 1 Chronicles 12, 19 to 22 retells this story in the space of about 6 verses. And it tells us in those verses that there were people who came from Israel, specifically from the tribes of Manasseh, to join with David in this fight. So it wasn't David and his 400 men against all of these Amalekites, although that would make a really great story, and God could certainly do that. We know the story of Gideon. But there were others who allied themselves with David. They were done with Saul. Saul and Judah, they're going to battle against the Philistines up in the north. There were other tribes, Manasseh included, who said, you know what? We don't want to hang with Saul. We don't agree with what he's doing. We realize that he is not really the king of Israel anymore, although he is positionally. We realize David is the next king of Israel. And they came and they allied themselves with David to go undertake this battle. So it is this grouping of people that come to do battle with David that contained in that group are wicked and worthless men. They're just in it, well, they're in it for the spoils. And there will always be those. In any group of people that are being led, there will always be those who are on the fringes, who are on the edge, who they're in it for some other reason, some other motivation than the rest of the group. And these people, they show their stripes. They said, hey, wait. Verse 22, because they did not go with us, we will not give them any of the spoil that we have recovered, except for every man's wife and children, that they may lead them away and depart. Hey, you can have your families back, but you don't get any of your stuff. Well, who are they to talk? David is the commander of this group. And notice how David responds. This is important as we begin to close, because you see the heart of a man who's experienced a restoration by God. David could have said, I can't believe you guys, give me my sword, and start taking off their heads. Or he could have lambasted them and upbraided them. He could have done all kinds of things. Notice how he responds. This is a man who's experienced the grace of God. He said, my brethren, you shall not do so with what I have given us. That's not what he says. You shall not do so with what the Lord has given us, who has preserved us and delivered into our hand the troop that came against us. For who will you heed in this matter? But as his part is who goes down to the battle, so shall his part be who stays by the supplies. They shall share alike. And so it was from that day forward that David made it a statute and an ordinance for Israel to this day. Let me just say, if you're one of those individuals who serves in this ministry, who you think nobody sees your ministry or nobody knows your ministry, nobody knows any idea of what you do, hey, first thing, praise the Lord. See if you can keep it like that. That's the best way. Don't get your rewards, don't get your blessings here in this life. Stack them up for the next life when you're standing before the King of Kings. But secondly, I want you to know this, is that you are as much of a part of the blessing that comes upon this ministry and comes into this ministry as the person who stands up here every Sunday and every Wednesday front and center. The blessing is the same for each of us. As we move together as a family, as we work and we serve together as a family, whether your part is a little part or your part is a big part, whether your part is up front or your part is behind the scenes. Now, if you don't have a part, you need to talk to Jesus about that. Because you need to have a part of what God is doing. You need to have a part of the body of Christ working in this place. That's part of being a family. We all serve together. But that's a different discussion. Whether you're out front, whether you're behind the scenes, everybody has a part of the blessings. Well, when David came to Ziklag, verse 26, he sent some of the spoil to the elders of Judah, to his friends, saying, here is a present for you from the spoil of the enemies of the Lord. And I'm going to skip all those names again. Watch me. Verse 31. And he sent the spoil to all the places where David himself and his men were accustomed to rove. David is going to soon be king, almost at the same exact time that these events are taking place right here with David. Well, it's possible at this moment David could already be king and doesn't know it. Because while this is going on, the next two chapters, and you're looking at your Bible and going, wait, there's only one more chapter. No, it's actually two more chapters. In the next two chapters, Saul's actually battling the Philistines up in the north and will lose his life. So David takes these spoils and he distributes them out to those who have blessed him in the past. I want to close with this from John chapter 12. Jesus says this, "He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also." This morning, Christian, I want to ask, who are you following? Who are you leading? Where are you leading them to? Are you leading them to Achish? Are you leading them to Aphek? Are you leading them to Ziklag? Or are you leading them to God? Or are you following to God? Jesus says that we are to serve him. Jesus says that we're to follow him. Jesus says that if we're his servant, that wherever he is, there we will be also. And he says, if anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. Let's make sure this morning that as we close, we would be those who would find ourselves strengthening ourselves in the Lord our God. If we find ourselves here this morning and we are that individual in that backslidden state, Christian, don't stay there. Get right with the Lord this morning. Strengthen yourself in the Lord your God this morning in this place. And don't leave this place until you've taken care of that. If anyone serves me, let him follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. Father, thank you for your word to us this morning yet again through the life of David. Father, thank you that you would give to us an example, a picture of a man who, like us, not perfect at all. And yet, a man who knew the way back, a man who knew how to turn, a man who knew how to repent. Father, keep our hearts far away from being Sauls in this world. Father, keep us far away from being like Saul, who lived in his self-will, Lord. We know who lived in his own determination, who lived in his own hardness of heart, who lived by his own wits and his own means, who was his own man, who made his own decisions, made his own bed. And who in next week's Bible study will in fact lay in it. But Father, may we be those who have the hearts of David. Hearts after you. Hearts sold out for you. Hearts in love with you. Because Lord, you first loved us. Thank you for blessing us and speaking to us through your word this morning. May we be those in this coming week who would find ourselves strengthening ourselves in you, the Lord, our God. And it's in that name we pray.